Hello friends, this is Dr. Sangeeta from Dental Pathshala, where we help you understand and learn dentistry better and easy way. And today's topic is a continuation of the transport across cell membrane. The first part, the passive transport, we have already covered in the previous video, and today's video will be covering the active transport across the cell membrane. So let's get started. Lecture, we have covered the passive transport. Today's video will be studying the active transport. As I've told you, I have given an idea about active transport. It is the uphill process. It is the uphill movement. In this process, there is the substance is going to move from the low concentration to the high concentration. So because we are going from low till we are climbing the uphill, so we require fuel, we require energy. So this is known as the active transport, which requires ATP, which requires fuel. So A signifies for active and A signifies for the ATP. So this requires from the low concentration to the high concentration, thus it requires energy. It is against the concentration gradient, it is against the electrochemical gradient. So it requires energy and it requires a carrier protein, which is going to carry to the cell membrane, which is going to carry do all the movements. So active transport, it requires ATP, it requires metabolic energy, so hence it is termed as active transport. Now we have two kinds of active transport, the primary active transport and the secondary active transport, and it is divided based on the energy which is utilized. So if the direct energy is utilized for the transport of the substance, for the movement of the substance, it is known as the primary active transport, and if the energy which is utilized is secondary, is known as the secondary active transport. The energy which is indirect is known as the secondary active transport. So primary active transport, when the movement of the solute is happening with the breakdown of the ATP, so when the ATP is broken down into ADP and a phosphate molecule, so this energy which is used for the direct transport of the substance, for example, there are three examples for this. The most important is the sodium potassium ATPase pump. So we'll be discussing this pump in the detail in this video. Now this pump, it utilizes ATP to cross the membrane, now in this sodium potassium ATPase pump, actually three potassium are going out. Now I have to make you understand this first. This is the extra cellular fluid, this is the intracellular fluid. Now we have sodium and chloride ions in the extracellular fluid. In the intracellular fluid, we have potassium and phosphate ions. So this, when the sodium is going against the electrochemical gradient, so sodium is already high in the extracellular fluid. Now when it is coming from low concentration to high concentration, we have low concentration of sodium in the intracellular fluid and we have high concentration of sodium in the extracellular fluid. So this the movement which is from low concentration to high concentration of the sodium and potassium is going in the reverse order, from low concentration to the high concentration. Now you will be asking, ma'am, why is this concentration, already we have so much of sodium, why you are pushing so much of sodium outside? Because of the passive diffusion. Now passive diffusion, what happens is we have lot of concentration of the sodium outside the cell already. Now because of the passive diffusion, because of the passive transport, the sodium will start coming in. Now to maintain the balance of the cell, to maintain the balance, we have to push, the cell pushes the sodium outside again. Now the outside, the sodium which is pushing outside the cell, which is against the electrochemical gradient, is our sodium potassium ATPase pump, which requires the ATP, which is against the electrochemical gradient. Now the secondary transport is when the sodium energy stored in the sodium concentration is used for the transport of any other molecule, which is utilizing the energy of the sodium to transport the other substances. This is the secondary transport. Now we have the symport and the antiport. In the symport, the same it is going in the same direction. Now when the sodium is transported via the potassium pump with the primary active transport, a large concentration of sodium is outside the cell. We have a high sodium concentration outside the cell, and this energy gradient is the storehouse for the glucose. Now there is this carrier molecule which is present at the extracellular fluid. Now this carrier molecule is, imagine this is sodium glucose transporters. So this is the sodium glucose transporter. This is the carrier molecule which is present at the extracellular fluid. Now sodium glucose transporter, which is present outside the cell, because sodium is already high in the outside in the ECF, now sodium binds to this receptor, which is our sodium glucose transporter. With this transporter, sodium is already added to this transporter, and also when the sodium is added to this transporter, it takes glucose also along with this, and this transporter goes inside the cell. Now this transporter, when the transporter goes inside the cell, it releases sodium as well as glucose. So this pump is acting with the sodium potassium pump the same. When the sodium is coming in, glucose is coming in, it act in the same direction too. So this is known as co-transport or symport. That means there the same movement of the glucose is in the same direction as in the sodium. There are also examples for the co-transport, that is, we have already discussed the transport of sodium with the glucose, and there are transports of sodium with the amino acids, which happens in the GI tract and the kidney tubules. So this utilizes our sodium glucose transport. Now another one we have in the secondary is our antiport. Antiporter are the exchangers. So the movement is happening against the concentration gradient and opposite direction to the sodium. Transport, will be studying this when the calcium is going in, the sodium is going out, the calcium is going in. So it is in the sodium calcium exchanger. Now we have primary active transport, secondary active transport. Primary active transport is the movement of solute, which is utilizing the ATP energy directly, which is directly coupled with the ATP breakdown, which is our sodium potassium ATPase pump, which is our hydrogen ATPase pump or the proton pump, which is present in the parietal still of our stomach, the HCl and the kidneys. Now the another one also we have for endoplasmic reticulum, calcium ATPase, which is present in the muscle, the primary active transport of the calcium. The another one we have is the secondary active transport, which utilizes the indirect energy, which is coming from the sodium. So sodium is taking along with the other substances. So we have co-transport or sim transport and the antiport or the co-transport. Now let's read it one by one. First we'll be starting with the sodium potassium ATPase pump. Now sodium potassium ATPase pump is very important for the exam point of view, and it is actually very important for a cell. You will come to know how it is very important for a cell. Now the sodium potassium ATPase pump is an example for our primary active transport, and it is happening against the concentration gradient. Suppose this is our extracellular fluid, this is the intracellular fluid. Now the sodium, which is already high in the extracellular fluid and low in the intracellular fluid, sodium is going out from the low concentration to the high concentration. If you get confused with this, just remember sodium is already high in the extracellular fluid, and this is the active transport, so it requires ATP. So it is against the electrochemical gradient or our chemical gradient, so it will be low to high. So the sodium are going out because sodium are already high outside the cell. So this ATP pump, it has 6 sites. Now we'll draw this ATP pump, which is in our cell membrane. So this is our ATP pump. Now this pump has 2 stages. It is a 2-stage process. We have 2 binding sites for the potassium, that is towards the extracellular fluid, and we have 3 receptors for the sodium, which is towards the intracellular fluid. Now this is the stage 1, and also there is one more site which is near to potassium, which is our for the ATPase. So this is the sodium potassium ATPase pump, which has 2 subunits. It has the sodium potassium ATPase pump has 2 subunits. Now the alpha subunit and the beta subunit. Alpha subunit is for used for the transport of the sodium and the potassium, and beta unit, which is the smallest unit, it is just the supporting unit. It supports the alpha unit. Now the sodium potassium ATPase pump has two subunit, alpha and beta, and the alpha subunit is used for the transport of sodium and potassium. It has six site. Now the outside towards the ECF is what is our potassium, and towards which is towards the ICF is our sodium. This is the stage one of the sodium potassium ATPase pump. Now what happens is, when the sodium second stage, when the sodium goes out, so what happens is, when the sodium goes out, this sodium potassium pump is reversed. So this sodium will go outside, so these receptors will be outside, and the potassium receptors will be, because potassium is coming in, potassium will be inside. So two sodium and two, three sodium are going out and two potassium are coming in. So this sodium potassium ATPase pump is, suppose if this is the ATP, it is utilizing ATP, and three sodium are going out and two potassium are coming in. So this is the sodium potassium ATPase pump. So three positive charge are going outside the cell and two positive are coming inside the cell. So there is a net loss of one positive, makes the inside negative respect to outside, because there is one positive outside, so there is one negative inside with every sodium potassium ATPase pump. And we have lots of sodium potassium ATPase pump in a cell, so there is lot of negative accumulate, becomes lot of negative. Now this negative charge you will study in the action potential, or this pump is present in all the membranes of all the cells throughout our body. So it is very important for the functioning of the nerves and the membranes of all the cells. Now this sodium potassium ATPase pump utilizes 40% of our total basal energy expenditure of the body, and if we talk about neurons, 75% of the energy is utilized by sodium potassium ATPase pump. It utilizes 1/4 of our total energy generated by a cell. So it also contributes to the basal metabolic rate. And the most frequently asked question is, the most important function of sodium ATPase pump is the regulation of the cell volume, which is very important. If all the options are the functions of sodium ATPase pump, then most important function is the regulation of the cell volume. How it regulates the cell volume? Now due to the passive transport, sodium is coming in. Now, if this active transport doesn't happen, sodium is stored inside the cell. Now, if so much of sodium is stored inside the cell, sodium has an osmotically active ion. So, sodium, it traps the water, it pulls the water through the osmosis, and the cell will swell up and there will be burst of the cell because of the osmolytic lysis. So it utilizes a volume of a cell by pushing the three sodium ions out. Now we have three special type of active transport, which is our exocytosis, endocytosis and transcytosis. Now exo means out, cytosis means outside the cell. Now if cell is expelling something out of it, if the cell is expelling something, is known as, without passing the cell membrane, if the cell is vomiting something out, is known as the exocytosis. Now exocytosis is the cell vomiting. Now exocytosis happens with the use of secretory vesicles. The cell uses secretory vesicles to excrete out. Now a very good example of exocytosis is our nerve terminals. Acetylcholine, which is released at the nerve terminal. Suppose this is a nerve terminal, we'll be studying in the active transport again. Now this is a nerve terminal. Acetylcholine is formed by, acetyl is formed by the mitochondria, acetyl CoA, and choline is transported from outside of the cell with the help of a choline transporter, which is present at the cell membrane. Now both of these together form acetylcholine with the help of the choline acetyl transferase enzyme. Now there are few vesicles of acetylcholine present in the nerve terminals. Now these are full of acetylcholine. Now I'll make this vesicle big one. This is our acetylcholine vesicle, which is full of acetylcholine. It has two proteins. Now the one protein is the synaptobrevin, which is present at the acetylcholine receptors. Now this, if this is a membrane ending, we have something known as syntaxin, which is also a docking protein. We have already discussed two docking proteins. One is our synaptobrevin, syntaxin, which is present at the cell membrane. Now this vesicle bound with the syntaxin and releases the ACH. Now the vesicle is merged in the cell and it releases the ACH at the nerve terminal. So this is also a type of exocytosis, wherein the cell is vomiting out acetylcholine. Now the if the docking proteins are inactivated, for example the botulinum toxin, which causes the flaccid paralysis. Now if the botulinum toxin is given, this docking proteins are inactivated, so they fail to release the ACH and there is no active potential, so there is a flaccid paralysis of the muscles. Now exocytosis are studied in the two pathways. One is our regulated pathway, also known as non-constitutive pathway, and the other one is the constitutive pathway. Now the non-constitutive or the regulative pathway is when the, for example, in case of enzymes or hormones, or we have discussed the neurotransmitter ACH. Now what happens is there is synthesis. The pathway is regulated. That means there is synthesis, there is processing, there is storage, and then release of the, for example, hormone. If we talk about, for example, glucagon by the alpha cells and ACH at the neuromuscular junction, serotonin by the Magnus nuclear cells, and the enzymes by the pancreatic acinar cells. Now the other one we have is the constitutive pathway. In this, there is synthesis and there is no processing or storage. The secretion, the whatever the product which is synthesized is not processed or stored. Whatever is synthesized is released simultaneously. So there is secretion of immunoglobulin by plasma cell. There is no storage or processing of the immunoglobulins by the plasma cell. Or there is collagen of the fibroblast. The fibroblast secretes the collagen directly. As soon as they synthesize, they release it. There is no processing or no storage. So this is about exocytosis. Now the another one we have is the endocytosis. Endo means inside. So endo is when a cell is taking anything inside it. So endocytosis is studied under three headings. The first one is the pinocytosis. Now endocytosis is when cell is taking anything inside it. The other one is the phagocytosis, which we already have studied in our pathology. Phagocytosis. And the third one we have is the receptor mediated endocytosis. So pinocytosis is the cell drinking. Pinocytosis we are talking is when the cell, now this is when, imagine this is a cell, and if something is near to the cell, now the cell starts making hyphae around it. Now these are the hyphae, and then cell engulf it, making a endosome. So this is a endosome. This endosome is a primary lysosome. It then converts to the secondary lysosome, which contains the hydrolytic enzyme, which helps in the digestion. So this is about the pinocytosis. We all know about the phagocytosis. There is pseudopodia formation, and phagocytosis is the cell eating, which takes the large molecules. The most important phagocytic cell is our neutrophil. The largest one is the macrophage. Now the phagocytic cells are the neutrophil, monocytes, or the macrophages. Now coming to the receptor mediated endocytosis. Receptor mediated endocytosis takes hormones, lipids, viruses, antibodies. Now these receptor mediated endocytosis occur due to a protein which is known as clathrin. Now this is a clathrin which has a receptor for the hormones. Now a pit is formed in this clathrin protein, and the ligand molecule binds to the receptor and makes a complex. Now it makes a complex, a receptor mediated complex. Now the pinocytic mechanism happens. The endosome or the primary lysosomes form the secondary lysosomes, then the hydrolytic enzymes help in digestion of it. Coming to the transcytosis or the vesicle trafficking. Now there is a trafficking. Trafficking means there is a hijack. Now the substance is actually passing the cell. It is not coming inside the cell. It is just passing the cell. So the receptor molecule caveolin, it is used for the transport of vitamins, which is present in the endothelial cells, and it is used for the absorption of the nutrients. So there, if this is the cell, this is the endothelium, this is the exothelium. Now immunoglobulins, which are present outside, they are coming inside in form of vesicles, immunoglobulins, and they pass out. So this is the transcytosis or cytopemphysis. Now this finishes our active transport. We have studied the primary, secondary, symport, antiport, and special type of active transport: exocytosis, endocytosis, and transcytosis. If you like our video, give it a thumbs up. I hope that I helped you understand and learn the transport across cell membrane. If you have any questions, leave it in the comment below, and I'll see you soon.